All right, well, as you know, here on Power Breakfast, we like to start off the week on an inspirational note, getting to know various power women from all around Kenya. And my guest for today is no different. She's a special needs parent and founder of Pearls Garden School, Susan Gichuki. Welcome to Power Breakfast.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we both decided to wear red this morning.
Yeah, it was just a coincidence. It was a memo.
Yeah. Mm. First of all, did I say your last name correct?
Yeshuro.
Okay.
Yeshuro, yeah.
All right, got it. Yeah. Sorry about that. Mm-hmm. Now, you have a very powerful story.
Yeah.
Your son was diagnosed with autism
in
2014.
Yeah.
So you are a mother of three.
Yeah.
So tell us about what that diagnosis, that period was like, the initial diagnosis.
Yeah. Okay, from the diagnosis, I was devastated. Like any other special needs parent, the moment you are told that your child has a certain condition, I was extremely devastated. And I took some time, like all other mothers too, to deny, to just say, no, that was a wrong diagnosis. My child is okay. And I believed that he was fine. But with time, I realized that in as much as I'm in denial, I'm wasting my child's time. I need to realize what's the best way forward. I need to do the best thing as early as possible. And that is when I went deep into research. I used to sleep overnight in the internet, calling all doctors, all my friends, and ask them, what is this autism and what do I need to do? Is there a cure for my child? And all doctors were like, no, there's no cure, but there are remedies to help alleviate the symptoms.
Yeah.
And that is when I discovered, along the way, I discovered the autism diet, the gluten casein free diet, and then started implementing it.
Mm-hmm.
And woe unto my shock, my son started saying words. He was 100% hyperactive.
Wow.
And he went to 0% hyperactive.
Yeah, I guess we can begin there because for people who are not familiar with what autism actually is, you know, what are the signs or what was going on with your son that made you think there's something a little bit different about him?
For me to realize that there was a problem, at the age of 2, my son did not have any word, not a single word at all. And he was very hyperactive, jumping up and down, running around, just chaotic.
Mm.
And I was like, is this, they call it terrible 2. But I was like, this terrible 2 and there's no words.
Yeah.
Nothing is happening. He's not saying anything. And so I stayed and I realized that there's an issue because he even didn't like to stay with children. And that is one of the characteristics of autism.
Mm-hmm.
They love to seclude themselves.
Mm-hmm.
They love to be alone because they have a social interaction problem.
Mm-hmm.
That is when I realized that there's an issue with my child.
Mm-hmm.
And that is when I started. I decided to look for help from a professional.
So you went, you got the diagnosis.
Yeah.
You were still probably in denial.
I was
at
in
this
denial.
Point.
Yeah. Mm.
At which point did you decide, let me do something to help my son? You know, I can't just be in denial forever.
Yeah, I realized I can't stay in denial for long. I can't cry forever. I need to wake up and do something because my son was looking up to me as a mother to do the best. And that is when I decided, at the age of 3, I decided to start implementing everything I read, everything I did my research, and I was very successful. He started gaining words, he started saying words, he started even fixing one word and another to make a short sentence, and I realized, wow, if I have succeeded with my son, then I can succeed with other children.
So at that point, let's just be clear, you weren't taking him to any type of therapy, you were just focusing on the diet, okay?
Yeah. I was taking him for speech therapy, but it was not intense. Because speech therapy in Kenya is very expensive.
Right.
It's extremely expensive. So I would skip days because maybe I could not afford because it was very expensive. But I tried to work with one speech therapist, Mr. Haron Kimani, and he really helped my son. And when I discovered that, because the neurologist who diagnosed my son told me only two things will help your child: the special diet and the speech therapy. Two things only.
Mm-hmm.
And so I had to be very keen with those things that the neurologist had advised me.
At this point, had you had any interaction with other parents who have special needs children, or did you know anyone sort of going through the same situation that you were?
No, Joy, I was all alone. I was in my own world because I was in denial. I didn't want other people to know what I was going through. So I was all alone.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I had not interacted with other mothers.
You talked about the expense of it all, and and since these are special needs children, they do require special help, and it can get, like you're talking about, the therapy being expensive, and You know, how did you sort of navigate through that? Because I'm sure that's an expense that you had not planned for.
I had not planned for that. And woe unto my shock. To look for the school, it was very hard for a good school for my son, whereby they would implement everything that the doctor had said. Because the doctor had said, if it is the special diet, it has to be extremely strict. No compromise. Not giving whatever will affect this child. Mm. So when I was looking for the school, I realized that if one school had the diet, they didn't have the speech therapy.
Right.
If another school had the speech therapy, they didn't have the diet. And so I realized, oh no, I have to start a school for my son. And that is when I started Pulse Garden School. Yeah.
That's a big leap. I mean, from helping your son to saying, now I want to help other children.
Yeah.
Was there any fear involved there? Were you hesitant? How did that come about?
No, I didn't have any fear because I met with this speech therapist that I've told you about, Mr. Haron Kimani. He's a special needs teacher. And when I told him about I met him when I was looking for a school for my son. Mm-hmm. When I told him about my frustrations and how I feel frustrated so much because I can't get to find the right school. I told him I need to start my own school, and he said, we will start our own school.
Wow.
So he had the expertise, he was a professional, he knew all about the special needs, he knows all about autism and other special needs, and so he told me, yes, we can do this, and so we partnered, and right now we have the school.
Where is the school located?
The school is in Thome.
Okay.
Yeah, just next to Ruaraka Academy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And from the time that you had the idea to start the school, mm-hmm. when you actually opened your doors, mm-hmm. how much, because there's quite a bit of work involved there, mm-hmm. so how much time did that take?
Because of my desperation, the school just took 1 month to start.
Wow.
We just started. In 1 month, we had already started.
Mm-hmm.
Because Mr. Haron had all the expertise. He had the teachers. He had everything.
Mm-hmm.
So I only needed to just bring my expertise as a mother and as a parent.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that is why you find that most of our parents are very confident in us. Because we have a special needs teacher and I am a mother.
Mm-hmm.
So I know everything about the diet. I know everything about their challenges. And Mr. Haron knows everything about special needs education.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How do you go about admitting students to this school? I mean, in terms of the screening process, because, you know, special needs is a kind of a general category.
Yeah.
There are many
mm-hmm.
Different ailments within that. So how do you select who gets to come to your school?
Yeah, we have to do an assessment. Once the child comes, Mr. Haron has to do an assessment and just gauge the child. Where is the child at and where do we begin as a school? And that is the first start. That is the first thing that we do once a child comes to our school.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How many students are currently enrolled?
Mm-hmm. Right now we have 20 to 25.
Wow.
And we are only in the second term.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's quite amazing.
Yeah.
And I'm sure, you know, you've helped quite a number of parents as desperate as you were.
Yeah, many children came. They were not toilet trained. Right now they are toilet trained. Many came without a single word. Right now they have words because I realized there was a huge gap in the society. Parents were desperate. They didn't know where to take their children.
Mm.
Some of them are locking their children at home, and not that they can't afford to pay school fees.
Yeah.
Just because of the stigma.
Exactly,
in the society.
And maybe we can talk more about that stigma, especially in African culture.
Mm.
We have not completely understood certain diseases.
Yeah.
And so you just kind of lock it away. You say, that's a problem that I don't really want everyone else to know about. So how do you go about kind of destigmatizing special needs children?
Yeah, because actually there's a problem in the society. Like I told you, I went through a lot of challenges. Like so many mothers come to me and they tell me, I don't go to church anymore. And I'm like, why? They tell me the ushers always push my child outside and they tell me to go home and display my child. And that is why I want to thank my pastor, Pastor Prince Jack, because he has been an understanding pastor.
Mm.
He took my son, he saw the way my son was throwing tantrums in church, and he just loved him. And he set a good example to other mothers. In my own local church at Dominion Tabernacle, we have 3 autistic children.
Wow.
So you can just imagine how many autistic children are outside there.
Mm.
The society has caused a lot of stigma. Because you know, Joy, you can't see autism. I can't look at you and say you have autism.
Mm.
Because it's not that I'm disabled, not that I have a broken leg or a broken hand. No, autism doesn't show.
Mm.
It is not physical.
Mm-hmm.
The other disabilities that show are like cerebral palsy, the one which has problems with muscle coordination,
mm-hmm.
and Down syndrome. But for autism, it doesn't show. All people say is that, why doesn't your child talk?
Mm.
And I want to ask everyone, kindly stop asking questions. A mother might be going through a lot and you're just asking her questions that she doesn't have answers to. Because so many people used to ask me, where doesn't your child talk? Mm. At his age, he should be talking. Mm. And I had a lot of work to just explain, oh, he has autism.
Now you have to explain to each person.
Each and every person that I meet. Yeah. So I don't think it is fair. The society really has not understood what autism is.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it is high time, because we are a very fast growing country, it's high time that Kenya understood what autism is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that we can support these parents, we can support them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, having a child with special needs takes quite a toll on the family.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm sure your plans in 2014 were, you know, to continue life as it were, but this came and sort of shook your whole world.
Yeah.
Maybe you can talk about what type of toll it's taken on your family life.
Yeah. Actually, it really surprised me. The moment I came from the doctor's office and I had to implement what the doctor had told me, I was surprised at how autism is expensive. I was so shocked. The therapy is so expensive. The special diet is extremely expensive. The schools were so expensive. The schools that are doing the right thing were extremely expensive. Everything is expensive. And to my surprise is that you can't get an autistic child into a matatu. You can't use a matatu because he'll start causing tantrums.
Mm.
He'll start wanting to walk around the matatu, just making noise, you know, crying, and everyone is just looking at you. So I'm just urging our dear president, I know soon he'll give me an appointment, to kindly consider us. The special needs parents, we are going through a lot. It is extremely expensive.
Mm-hmm.
If we can only manage even to exempt us from taxation. Like I feel every home with an autistic child will have a car. Because, Joy, you can't travel with these kids. You can't even go a long distance. They'll start walking up. They start making noise, rolling on the floor. And just everyone is looking at you and just telling you, can you discipline your child?
Mm-hmm.
It is so hard.
Mm-hmm.
And the diet is extremely expensive.
Yeah.
Because you can't give this child bread. You can't give them biscuits, you can't give them mandazi, you can't
gluten
just give
free.
Anything. Mm-hmm. It is gluten, casein free. You can't give milk.
Wow.
And if you can't give a child milk, what will you give?
Mm-hmm.
It is extremely expensive. And the therapy is very expensive. And that is why you find many parents are taking shortcuts.
Mm.
They are not doing the right thing because they cannot afford.
Yeah.
And that is why I decided, let Pearl Garden School be a one-stop shop. Once your child comes there, everything is done there.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to go to the hospital anymore, except if you need reviews, if you just need a doctor's opinion. But everything, even the nutrition diet, we call doctors from outside and they come there and hold workshops.
Yeah.
And they advise the parents.
So this is a manageable condition.
Condition, yeah.
Is it a lifetime sort of sentence once someone is diagnosed with autism? Is this to be expected for the rest of their life? They have to go through therapy and such things? Or?
No. It is not a lifetime death sentence. Actually, when the doctor pronounced that your kid has autism, to me it was like, wow, that is like worse than cancer. Because from what I had read before, I had seen that autism was a lifetime condition. But there's good news to all the mothers and all the parents right outside there, that the moment, the earlier you discover that your child has autism, the sooner you begin intervening, your child will go back to normal. If you start doing the right thing, the early intervention, it is called early intervention. The faster you discover, then you start doing the right thing, your child will just transist. So many children have transisted and gotten into the regular system. They move from the special unit onto the regular system. But this can only happen if you intervene as early as possible. It's an early thing.
There might be people watching, like I said, who don't have a great understanding of what autism is and are thinking, well, what causes that? You know, what is it, something that you did wrong, or, you know, is it an environmental thing? Because we've heard it mostly in the West. Like you said, here in Kenya, the knowledge that we have is not quite up to par. So maybe what are some of the causes of autism? Are there any?
They say that autism has, the cause for autism is not yet known. But so many doctors lean towards the genetic factor. They say that mostly it is genetic. Others say it is environmental. But I realized that trying to find the cause for my child's condition was taking a toll on me. Because I was wondering, did I do anything wrong?
Exactly.
Did I offend anyone? Is this a curse? Joy, everyone told me to even go get prayed for. They told me to, there's a ganga somewhere who can, I was told everything. But when I discovered that there's no cause for autism, that it is not my fault as a mother, it is not my husband's fault as a father, I realized then, maybe it's just any other, like any other condition. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but the society just tells you, I think this is witchcraft.
We're so quick to jump to that.
Yeah, it is witchcraft.
Culture, yeah.
So many mothers have told me that even their mothers-in-law call them and tell them, I think this problem has come from your side. And it is causing a lot of toll in marriages. So many mothers come to me and tell me that my husband ran away the moment our child was discovered that he had a special needs condition. My husband just deserted us. And I'm urging all husbands, kindly, it is high time you stick to your families. The moment their child is diagnosed with any condition, it is time that you support that child, you give him, you show him how to be a man if he's a boy, you support your wife, because it is no one's fault.
Yeah.
But how can you run away from a problem?
I think it goes back to the lack of understanding that we have of this disease, that it can be managed, that there are schools for it.
Yeah.
You know, and you just think, my child, there's something wrong with my child, and I'm not, you know, willing to be in this situation any longer.
Yeah.
Talk about Pearls Garden School and what you hope to achieve there. What's, you know, what's kind of the plan going forward? You said you have 20 students that you're helping out right now, but where do you see that going?
Yeah, I know, because Pearls Garden is doing the right thing. We are doing the right thing. Because for me and Mr. Haron, it's not business as usual. It's not the money we put in our pocket, but it is the impact that we are making in these children. And that is why I am praying that God may just expand Pearls Garden. And he's going to expand it, because there's a lot of need. There was a time, some time back, I think a month ago, I was on NTV, and the phone calls, that they were just overwhelming. There were so many, there's a lot of need outside there. People are telling me, can't we come to Mombasa and open a branch?
Mm.
But we can't do that. We can't go to all the counties and open branches. We need first to grow Pearls Garden.
Mm.
And so at the moment, because of the need that we received from that time, we are creating a boarding. So soon we will have a boarding at Pearls Garden School, and the parents can be able even to concentrate with their careers, to concentrate with their jobs. And this house girl stress can be minimized.
Yeah.
Because the house girls are really mistreating these children.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So you were talking about a fundraiser that you're going to be holding soon.
Yeah.
Tell us more about that.
Yeah. We are going to have a fundraising on the 8th of April, and we're inviting all corporates, all the leaders in government, all stakeholders, kindly to come and sponsor, to just partner with us, sponsor a child, because joy, it is very expensive.
Mm-hmm.
Education is very expensive. For myself and Mr. Haron, we just tried to work within a budget, but now we have realized there are so many parents who can't even afford the minimum that we are charging.
Mm-hmm.
And so we need these children to be sponsored.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why we thought, let us have a fundraising so that we can invite companies, we can invite corporates, we can invite government officials to just come. Because the moment we come, they come and they partner with the school, we can be able to sponsor.
Mm-hmm.
We can sponsor children from needy families. We can buy therapy equipment.
Yeah.
We can buy everything that this child needs. We can buy laptops, because these children are very inclined to IT. They need their IT to be harnessed. But how can we do that if we don't have the machinery, if we don't have the equipment? And therapy equipment are very expensive.
So you seem to have quite a passion for this, obviously, and I'm just, you know, sitting here as our power woman today wondering what keeps you going, what sort of drives you to continue the work that you're doing?
Yeah, I can tell you, Joy, it has been challenging. It has been challenging. It has taken a toll on my personal life. Because sometimes I see a child come to the school and I wonder, oh God, the mother is just crying, the dad is just crying. Sometimes they are blaming each other in my office. This came from you, this came from me. And I'm like, oh God, what is all this?
Mm-hmm.
So it has really been challenging.
Mm-hmm.
Because sometimes I look at the kids and they are so nice, they are so loving. And I'm just telling God, if this child is nonverbal, kindly give him some words, because I know you can do that. So it has been my work as a mother to even pray for those children.
Mm.
And just, I feel that so much has been placed on my shoulders to impact on these children and many more. The society is waiting right outside there.
Mm.
So many parents call me and tell me, we can't afford to pay school fees. We need to be sponsored. We need to be helped. But we cannot afford that as Past Garden. Mm. And that is why we have the fundraising on the 8th of April. Mm. All roads will be leading to Past Garden to just come and support the initiative.
Perhaps you can also give us your contact information. You have a Facebook page.
Yeah, we have a Facebook page, Past Garden School. And we have our phone numbers. My number is 0727-920-911. Mm-hmm. And my co-director's number is 0724-507-662. Mm-hmm. And you are always welcome. Anyone who has a special needs child, you are welcome to visit the school. Our school is in Dome, Nyati Drive, just after Ruaraka Academy. Mm-hmm. Yeah, our offices are always open.
Suzanne, thank you so much for being here.
Yeah.
You are such a great voice for special needs parents and children as well. And I wish you all the best at the fundraiser as well.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much for watching Power Breakfast this morning. Hope you have been enlightened on this beautiful, bright Monday morning. We are going to have a little bit of music before the show wraps up. But, of course, Citizen Extra is coming up next, so do keep it here on Citizen TV. On behalf of myself, Buddhist Abu, Fred Indimuli, we'll see you back here tomorrow morning. Mm-hmm.